it's a great educational program, and it'll reach kids that normal classroom teaching doesn't. A lot of after-school programs go through 4A sometimes in the year. Those ladies are up there every night almost. It's just unbelievable the time they put in these kids trying to work with their projects. Also, summer camp. Anybody ever been to 4-H camp? That's a big program. We'll take kids to camp. We have a lot of time here. We can bring 4-H camp, only hold 1,000 kids per week. And their camp season runs from June to the end of July. So there's about 8 weeks of camp. So we got to squeeze in all these kids all throughout Georgia in the camp in those 8 weeks. And we have about, I think, 60 spaces. So kids can go to camp, and camp is getting more and more expensive like everything else these days. When I was in Camden County about 7 years ago, it was like $240 for a week. That includes all the food and everything else. And that's pretty expensive, but now it's over $300, and it's just getting more expensive all the time. So we do things to help lower the cost to those kids. We have fundraisers. Kids can sell 5-day onions. They sell it for $10 a bag, and they get to keep $6 per bag. And that'll go towards their camp fund. So, you know, we try not to let money be an issue as far as participating in some of these events. And some of these fundraisers we do, they'll pay for district project community speaking events. We don't charge the kids for that, but it costs us probably $80 a kid to take them to Rock Eagle for a weekend. They stay at the cabins, and they feed them, and they bring them back. So, it's fairly expensive, but we've had a very successful year fundraising. Those ladies up there, they're creative. We have what's called a vista worker, which is a person who's like a year-long appointment officer. It's one of the counties that got one. And basically, they help fundraise, and we've had a lot of success. You might have heard of the Kids Day program for an event. That's something we do in the fall that raises money. We have to pay for our new minibus. So we pay about half the cost of that. The county also kicked in part of that. So we are funded by the county and the state mostly. And we're very appreciative of our commissioners being very supportive of extension. And we just couldn't do without that. And extension is a partnership between the county and the state. And I think there's a few federal dollars thrown in there. Of course, at our level, we don't handle all the dollars. That's done up in Athens at the university. And so every time you hear a budget being cut from the state, you know, we might get that cut, and then the county might cut 2 years later. So it's just our budget's all over the place because we've got so many factors. And now to worry about the federal budget, that portion being cut. So, but we're making, we had a few dry years where we couldn't hire anybody for 4 years. People that did what I do, and now we have me, and hopefully we'll get a new full value extension soon. And they're hiring a lot. They were told the university was told to hold back a certain. They did their budgets well in advance. They were told to hold back 3%, and I think at the end of the year they got back like 0.7%, which is like hundreds of thousands of dollars, you know, on a large budget. And they were able to hire some new people. That. So they've been on the hire and tear here recently, so that's good news. And I can go on and just talk a long time, but if y'all have any questions, I'll just let y'all ask me any questions, because a lot of times when I get up and talk, people raise their hand and they kind of go in whatever direction. Yes, sir.
Our leader's still leading, or I'm sure she will be to function and ask some questions. I'm curious, how is research going with finding alternative uses for kazoo?
Oh, for kazoo?
Yeah.
Well, the latest thing is there's a new pest that eats called kudzu bug. Gretchen knows about this bug. Kudzu, a lot of times these species that are invasive species, they're problems because they're introduced here and they don't have any natural predators. But somehow we have a kudzu bug now, and it loves kudzu. So they find them eating kudzu. So they didn't really have to do much research on that. Nature just kind of took care of that one, or taking care of that one. And that one was found here and confirmed in Georgia last year. But there's also some concerns that they love soybeans. So they're worried about them getting on row crops and things. So, you know, when you get a new species or a new accept, introduce, you don't know what it's going to do. And it's been found on wisteria, it's found on citrus. So they're not really sure what it's going to do. They think it's out there kind of looking for alternative hosts or other hosts that it might like. I saw one in that cornfield today. I was like, what you doing here? Scouted it out. But as far as other research, it's on pedestal, I don't believe. But like many things, they bring it in, think it's going to be a great thing, and it turns into an invasive plant. A lot of things were brought in for like forage or cattle, things like that, you know, nutritious legumes, and it just kind of gets out and comes up everywhere. So, thank you.
Speaking about kudzu, about a year ago in the local newspaper here, they had a young man, a high school student, I believe, who had been working on how to eradicate kudzu. And he was basically drilling into the soil with an auger, a small auger, and injecting some kind of chemical that actually killed the kudzu at the root level. And I'm just wondering if you heard, it sounds like something that a student in a 4-H club would be working in.
Yeah, some kids have interesting projects. There are a lot of herbicides that will kill kudzu. It's not impossible to kill. You know, there are things that you put out on the ground that will sterilize the ground for a couple of years. So, you may not have anything else for there. But I'm not sure what that kid was using.
Helium.
You've heard of that?
Yes, helium.
Tumor's Corner in Auburn. Anybody ever heard of that? That's like a big sacred football place at the campus of the University of Auburn. And they had these large trees, and they put a toilet paper up there after the game. And somebody, an Alabama fan, put a herbicide around those trees, and they killed Tumor's Corner live oaks. Mm-hmm. So there's always something that will get rid of plants. But the thing is, you'd like to find herbicides and get rid of your weed, but not hurt what you want to stay. So if you could spray something over kudzu, it wouldn't hurt all your other native shrubs. That'd be what you want to do. But it's hard to find things, especially with shrubs, things like that.
You want to say something about longleaf pines and what the threats are and what to watch out for with longleaf pine trees?
I'm sorry.
Longleaf pine trees and threats, pests, things to watch for.
Longleaf pines, those are pine trees that are, years and years ago, that was a predominant pine tree in our area, and they've been logged so much, and a lot of the programs when you plant pines back, you use slash or lolly, but more recently they've been trying to reincorporate longleaf pines, and the reason slash and lolly pines are being planted is because they grow faster. You know, people want to grow as fast as they can, because a tree, over your lifetime, that's a long-term investment. So people want to still be alive and actually harvest these things. So if you tack on 10 more years waiting for a longleaf pine, you may not be around to reap the benefits of cutting that timber. But it's a good native pine. It's resistant to fire and a lot of insects. So it's a good pine to try to grow. And there's programs now that are giving good incentives to plant longleaf pines. And they're harder to establish, too.
Well, actually, our longleaf started bolting after the first year. It turns out you just keep everything back a foot or two from the vine, and then the competition doesn't keep it down and it goes up. But I was wondering if you could say a few words about the economic importance of agriculture to the state of Georgia and its allowed county.
Yes, I can. I've actually got a little pamphlet here. It's called Ag Snapshots. I called and had some of these sent in. It's probably not very far to have. It just shows the value of agriculture in Georgia. Mm-hmm. Lowndes County has a farm gate value, which is, run out. Maybe Gretchen can bring some more. But in Lowndes County, the value of agriculture is about $70 million. And a lot of people don't realize how much impact agriculture has in Georgia. And here, we have a lot of probably half of that 70 million or more is vegetable production and row crops, corn, cotton, and peanuts. And we have a big vegetable industry in the south end of the county. They grow a lot of peppers, squash, cucumbers. The thing about vegetables is they usually get two crops a year. So they have a fall crop, and then they have a spring crop. So a lot of this produce is shipped all over the country. It just goes to different markets, but agriculture is a very important part of the economy in Georgia. And as far as how much each area impacts, it varies from county to county. Of course, they have a big poultry industry, so a lot of chickens and things. But a lot of jobs are related to agriculture indirectly, so you may not see the actual farm production may be worth this, but if it wasn't for this farm, this industry would dry up, and this industry would dry up. So it has like a chain reaction. So I'm thinking they say, I think 1/5 of the economy of Georgia is related to agriculture. And they say,
Lowndes. What is the order of, in terms of dollars, what is value, what is?
Probably row crops, whether it be cotton, corn is on the rise. The ethanol production, the corn prices have gone way up. So corn used to be just planted as a rotational crop, so they wouldn't plant cotton and peanuts every year.
Right.
And they hope to break even on corn, $3 to $4 a bushel. You know, if they got $4 a bushel, they would just tickle the peanut. But now, they get $8-$9 a bushel. So they're really, corn used to put it out there and plant it. Does good, that's good, it doesn't, and that's all right too. But now they're really trying to get serious about it.
So the corn we're seeing, is it ethanol corn or is it?
It's probably mostly livestock or ethanol corn.
Livestock.
Yeah, so that's what most of it is, field corn. So they irrigate that with water. Corn, it takes an incredible amount of water. So as far as the environment goes, it's sucking out some water, because you may need 3 inches per week to get a good deal off.
Is there any tobacco anymore?
Yeah. There's probably, I guess, 1,000 acres here. And there's probably 3 farmers that farm. But they seem to get a little bit bigger here. Most of the tobacco here is turned into cigarettes, and I think most of that goes overseas. But tobacco is a big crop. And it's not as much as there used to be, but it's kind of level off to where it's pretty consistent. And there's a lot of interesting information as far as growing tobacco. There's diseases out there. Anybody ever heard of tomato spotted wilt virus? It's a virus that affects over 100 types of plants. Tobacco is one of them. Of course, it affects tomatoes, peppers, a lot of crops, peanuts. We had gotten down to maybe one variety of peanut in Georgia that was resistant to tomato spotted wilt virus. And it was planted like 95% of all acres was that one variety. And that's kind of dangerous because if anything ever happens to that one variety, you're just out of business. And the researchers, the breeding programs for peanuts, they've come up with other varieties that have since come out that are more resistant to tomato spotted wilt. And some of the research indicated that if you planted before, I think, May the 8th, your incidence of tomato spotted wilt went up dramatically. And so they used to plant peanuts around April. It started in April and be probably 50% planted by May 8th. So since that disease came out, they started saying, all right, plant peanuts between May and June. And so that was the case for years. And these new varieties that they've come out with, they've come back saying, all right, you can start planting in April again because these varieties are so resistant. You can plant earlier. And that's good because you have more time to make the peanut yield better. Because if you plant too late, you're starting to get in October, it's a little nice to get cool, and a lot of your yield on peanuts is the last 2 or 3 weeks. So if you shut it down late, your yields are going to go down significantly. So.
I see 5 to 10 acre fields.
Oh, that's pretty good. That's probably 13,000 to 14,000 acres here.
Yeah.
In Lowndes County. But yeah, there's some large cotton fields. 2 years ago, the price of cotton, it used to hover around 70 cents a pound. 80 cents was pretty good, but it got up to about $1.50 a pound. Everybody's like, wow, you know, what's going on? But I think usually you have a big year in agriculture, somebody else has had a bad. So some other country had a poor year that year and the cotton prices go up. And the cotton prices kind of settled back down in the 70s, 80s. But there's a lot of cotton planted. That's probably the number one row crop around here. Brooks County has a lot, maybe 40, 50,000 acres. So Lowndes has kind of got a lot of population, but there's still a lot of different variety of crops and vegetables grown here. It's just not as big a quantity as in some other counties.
I spoke to a farmer in Brooks City who couldn't make money from cotton.
Yeah, well, they,
where it is right
I don't now. Know how they make money growing anything, too. You know, as much as diesel fuel costs,
yeah.
Running those tractors, those machines, this incredible amount of money, a lot of money passes through the farmer's hands. Prices for fertilizers and it's doubled over the last 4 or 5 years. Chemicals have gone up, insecticides, fungicides.
That's why the government subsidizes.
Yeah, and the Farm Service Agency, they have a program to help subsidize because if farmers went out of business, we'd hate to be dependent on other countries for our food. And we've never really had a food shortage in the United States that I remember. They may have been some. I know the World War II era that I heard the story.
It's one of the big problems that minorities are having right now because black farmers lost their farms because everybody was being subsidized by black farmers. And right now, I think they're having big problems with that.
Yeah, I think they have a lawsuit.
They had a lawsuit, they won the lawsuit. But county agencies sat on their thumbs and did not give them any of those farmers lost 300, 400, 500 acres because they could not pay their bills. They had the money up there waiting, but they weren't issuing the money. So they brought on yet another house.
I remember, I don't know if y'all know Cal Lewis, but he was a raven here who retired up. He said when he started, I think he started around 2000, that was one of the big issues his first 2 or 3 years was working on that issue with the farmers. And that, you know, like you said, supposedly was settling, it just like lingered from what I heard.
Jay, can you talk a little bit about some of the really great programs at that extension, like the hog show?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we have several livestock shows there. Hog show. The area hog show was in November, and kids in Lanier County, Brooks County, and Lowndes participate in that through FFA, through the school, or kids that want to do it through 4-H will participate in the hog show. And they'll get a pig, and then they will raise the hog. They usually get them around 100 pounds, get them up to about 220 to 270, and then they enter them in the hog show. And the hog is a regiment of their hog, the first show here what, a couple years ago, and you know, the little kids running around with the pigs, and they learned how to actually raise an animal, and so it's a good education event. Plus, it's very well attended. That place is packed with family members and media watching that. And they also have a livestock show for steers, and usually you have fewer kids showing steers because that's a lot more expensive. You know, you have to buy a cow. Cost you hundreds of dollars up front, and you got to feed that animal, and then you got to transport a cow. It's a whole lot harder to move a cow than it is a pig. So fewer people do that, but they'll take the cows to Perry, to the shows, and all over the state for these livestock shows. And so, and then they have a sale, and they sell the animal. But yeah, there are 3 shows here currently, and they're usually held all at our extension office. And we also have the ham and egg show. Anybody heard of that?
Yeah.
M&X show, and Gretchen has learned about that too, and that's been going on, I think this was the 63rd year of the M&X show, with the indoor hams, and then they have the ham, and then the judge comes down and judges the ham, then he rates them good, fancy, or choice, and then he announces the winner of the show, and then they auction off the hams, and they bring in farm-raised eggs, too. So that's a big show. It's a big event.
When is that?
February, usually the second or third week in February. Yep.
How many of those are there in the United States?
I think two. And I'm not sure where the other one is, but it's not close.
Kentucky.
Is it Kentucky?
That's what the judge said.
Oh, yeah. Any other questions? Well, when the economy kind of went south, you know, a lot of building programs were cut. But actually, Michael Adams was the president of the Georgia, threatened to cut out all the 4-H, close all the 4-H offices and camps. And they think that was dramatic. Nobody would take ownership of that move now. But I think that was a ploy to get them to raise taxes. If you can't raise, if you don't raise taxes, shut out 4-H. And that caused big uproar all over the state.
Sure.
All moms and daddies and grandparents called, and the legislators were just like, you can't do this, you're going to have to find a way to make it happen. But, I think that came from the president of the university. It was just kind of a political move. I don't think he ever really intended for it to happen. I think he knew what would happen if he did that. You know, that's just what I've heard. You know, he's retiring soon.